योगेन चित्तस्य पदेन वाचां मलं शरीरस्य च वैद्यकेन योपकरोत्तं प्रवरं मुनीनां पतञ्जलिं प्राञ्जलिरानतोऽस्मि आबाहु पुरुषाकारं शङ्खचक्रासिधारिणं सहस्रशिरसं श्वेतं प्रणमामि पतञ्जलिं। गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णुः गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुस्साक्षात् परब्रह्म तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। हरिः ओम्। So in the previous session, we finished looking at Sutra 2.28, which was Yoganga Anushthana Dashuddhikshaye Jnana Deepti Ra Viveka Khyatehe. So with that sutra, the notion of Yogangas was introduced by Vyasa's line that came before the sutra, where he said, Nacha Siddhihi Antarena Sadhanam Vityeta Dharabhyate. So the Siddhi or the attainment does not come without the Sadhanam, which is the means. And therefore, he said, the next section begins. And then came the Sutra Yoganga Anushthanat and so on. So by looking at the Sutra 2.28, in some sense, we have looked at the phalam or the prayojanam of the Yogangas. What does the Anushthanam of Yogangas give us or the give the yogi? It gives the Ashuddhikshaya. It also gives the Jnana Deepti. And to what extent is this Jnana Deepti? It is right up to Viveka Khyati. And before that we saw what happens with Viveka Khyati. Viveka Khyati is the ultimate state of Jnanam, where the knowledge of, complete knowledge of and realization of Prakriti, Purusha, and the distinction between the two come in. But we also saw that that itself is not an immediate something that is Kaivalya, because what that leads to is actually the removal of bandha or bondage. And then there is the end of the sanyoga between the Purusha and Prakriti, and then there is Kaivalyam. So we have seen that sequence, and this is where the Yogangas fit into the overall picture of Yoga Shastra right up to Kaivalya. Having seen that, today we start with Sutra 2.29, where the Ashtanga Yoga, the different Angas are mentioned. So the Sutra is, actually before going to the Sutra, let's look at Vyasa's small line that says, Tatra Yoga Angani Avadharyante. So the Yoga Angas, there is a Avadharanam. Avadharanam in some sense is affirmation. A clear specification with emphasis of this mention of Yogangas. What are these Yogangas? So instead of leaving it vague and open-ended, there is an avadharanam of Yogangas happening, says Vyasa in Sutra 2.29. And then comes the Sutra 2.29 that says, Yama niyama asana pranayama pratyahara dharana dhyana samadayo ashtangani. So yama niyama asana pranayama pratyahara dharana dhyana samadayaha ashtav angani. So the eight angas. So the yoga anga that was mentioned earlier, this is an enumeration of those yoga angas, yama niyama asana pranayama, and this is a well known sutra that almost everybody knows. So this is essentially an enumeration done by Patanjali, and as Vyasa says, this enumeration is done for reasons of avadharanam or affirmation. Now Vyasa gives a very brief bhashya to this specific sutra. So we will look at that, but we will also look at a few more things around it. Also we will look at what, in very brief, what each of these angas are. What is yama, what is niyama, in a very brief overview today. So before looking at each of those terms, maybe let us just quickly look at this very short bhashya that Vyasa has, where Vyasa just says, yatha kramam etesham anushthanam swarupam cha vakshyamaha. He says, okay, yatha kramam, as per this sequence, as per in the sequence given, yama, niyama, asana, in that sequence, etesham, of these, anushthanam. Again, in the last two sessions, there was some discussion of what anushthanam means. In some senses, it is establishing, inculcating, and so on. So, we look at, says Vyasa, anushthanam and swarupam, their nature, the understanding of their nature, their swarupa, and the understanding of their anushthanam, vakshyamaha, we will talk about it, says Vyasa. So, this is what the sutra is. Now, maybe we'll do a brief review of all these terms that, by which the Yogangas are so well known. So, Yamaha. So, Yama is Yamaha, Ahimsadayaha Pancha, which we'll see what are the five later in specific sutra. So, Ahimsa, Satya, Astaya, and so on. So, Ahimsadayaha Pancha are the Yamas. So, it is said that in most of the text, it is said that the Yamas are more Nishedatmaka and Nivritti Paraka. So, now first to understand the term Yama, it says Uparamyante Nivartyante Vishayebhyo Manasendriyaniti Yamaste Cha Ahimsadayaha Pancheti. So, the Yamas, it is set of, it is more about what is not to be done. Now, this is against nuance. It is not, we should not just take it as Yama simply means this is not to be done, that is not to be done. And we'll see that in the sutra that is specific to the Yamas. But largely speaking, Yamas are about Nisheda. So in general, in the Shastras, especially in the context of the Veda Vakyas, there is this notion of Vidhi Nisheda. Vidhi means something that needs to be done. It is a rule, it is an injunction. Nisheda means it is something that's not to be done. So in some sense, do's and don'ts. So Yamas are, the emphasis more towards don't, what is not to be done. So uparam, so the Yama, the term, it is the root verb is yam uparame. So therefore, uparamyante nivartyante vishayebhyo manasendriyani. So there is a something that is to be reduced, something that is to be attenuated. And in this particular line it says, the manas and indriya are going away from the vishayas, their objects. And these ahimsa, etc. are the five yamas. Now niyama. Niyama is also coming from the same root yam, uparame, but with the prefix ni. So, the niyamaha. So, now these are more known to be vidhi rupa. So, some observations that these are injunctions, something to be done. So, niyamyante, kriyante, nitaram yamyante iti niyamaha. So, shaucha adi niyamaha. So, we have seen the we will see shaucha santosha, tapaswadhya, ishwara pranidhana, nisaya, etc. So, these are more about observations to be done, something to be followed. So this more falls in the do's category, where yamas fall more under the don'ts category. So yama and niyama. Next is asanani. Asyate ebhi iti asanani. So the asanam, which we have already seen, there is a root is as, lut is the suffix, but the asanam is essentially is something in which you can settle, in something in which you could repose. In fact, even a chair or a comfortable, let's say the throne is known as simhasanam. So asanam is where somewhere you can settle and be steady. So asyate ebhi iti asanani. So that is asanam. Next is pranayama. So pranasya ayamaha or prananam ayamaha agati nirgati sthitishu vistaraha is pranayama. So there are several definitions or terms. Sometimes it is said prayatna visheshena shwasa nishwasa dharana shwasa dharanam pranayamaha etc. But here prananam ayamaha. So the ayama, in some sense it's usually said control or regulation, but it is also in lengthening, expanding. So it is here the term vistara is used. So the and always you will see the term prayatna vishesha, that is used with reference to pranayama, because it is considered something which is not very easy to specify in words, and therefore it is said guru upadeshat. So the prayatna vishesha is to be learned from the guru. So there is a specific way, and of course we'll see it in more detail when we look at the sutras on pranayama. But essentially here there is a vistara, lengthening, expansion and steadying the regulation of the pranas along with agati nirgati sthitishu. It is not necessarily by and through, but along with the incoming breath, outgoing breath and the breath that is in a state of sthiti, which somewhat crudely it is called inhalation exhalation. But because of the prayatna vishesha, and we will see later in the sutra related to pranayama what is rechaka, what is puraka and so on, but essentially this is in reference to the vistara and ayama of the pranas in conjunction with the agati and nirgati and the sthiti, of which is a reference to breath. So that is pranayama. Then comes dharana. So dharana is with reference to dhriti. So then comes pratyahara. Now the pratyahara, again we will be looking at it in sufficient detail when we look at that sutra. So here this is a very brief kind of a description of each. But pratyahara is about so prati ahara, so the indriyas essentially going away or drawing back from the vishayas, and when we'll see the specific sutra we'll say it is going in completely in conjunction, in collaboration with the manas and the chitta. So without going into too much detail right now, that is what pratyahara refers to. So the term is prati with one prefix, a is another prefix, and there is the verb root is r. So it is, and the essential meaning, so that is known as bhave, and a suffix called ghang. So similar to the same suffix from which yuj turns into yoga, here the prati, a and r turns into pratyahara or pratyaharanam. So that is the it is a yoganga vishesha with reference to, specifically with reference to the indriyas going away from their vishayas and following the direction, so to speak, or following the state or the vritti of the chitta. So that is the pratyahara. Then comes dharana. So dharana is in the, it is related to what is known as dhriti also. So dharana is dharyate ya sa dharana. So the verb is dhr, and the interesting part is there is this suffix called nich, which we have talked about earlier. So for example, the nich suffix comes when a verb turns into something about getting it done. So do is to do, but to get it done. So in Sanskrit and all Indian languages, there is this for every verb has a form about getting something done. So nyayate means to know, janati means to know, nyapayati means to make somebody know, to make someone understood, understand it. So patha means to read, pathaya means to make someone read or understand. So similarly here, the dhruva with the nich suffix. So dharyate ya sa. So it brings about a certain dhriti or ekatra sthapanam. Now sthapanam is also about getting something done. Tishtati. So that comes from stha or sthiyate means to be steady. Sthapayati means to make something steady. Okay, so it is the same nich prefix. So ekatra sthapanam is also the dharana. So here it is about the interesting use of the nich suffix here on the dhruva verb, that is dharana. Of course, we'll see the exact definition when the sutra comes. But here it is important to know that dharana is the chitta, the state of cognition is fixed. So that is the dhruti. Ekatra sthapanam, fixing in a certain place or position. And here we are being deliberately not bringing the definitions which we'll see in the later sutras, so that here we get a more broader understanding and also an understanding of the term. So that is the intent why it is being described this way right now. So the next one is dhyanam. Now it is sometimes wrongly understood that dharana and dhyanam are coming from the same verb root, and that is not true. So dharana is from dhru, leading to dhruti. Dhyanam is from a different verb called dhyai. So, and the suffix is lyut, same as for asanam. As becomes asanam, dhyai becomes dhyanam. So the dhyanam is more about the pravaha of the jnanam or the prajna. So the ekatra sthapanam that happened, the fixing of the alambanam or the support of the chitta, the state of the cognition, the fixing of which happened as part of dharana, the flow of it, the pravaha of that state of cognition, that is what is referred to by dhyanam. Again, I need to clarify, in dharana, when it says fixing of it, it is not as though the yogi fixes it. It gets fixed. Okay, so therefore, that is the term dharana, where it says dharyate ya. So the dharana itself is fixing it. So similarly, the dhyanam, that fixed state of cognition flows on its own. And that once that state is reached, that is known as dhyanam. And then comes samadhi. Now the samadhi, again, so the dharana dhyana samadhi, or there is this some confusion because of the again sometimes it is seen as the same verb root. So samadhi is sam and a and dha. So there's the dhatu here is dha, and so samadhi is then the flow that came in the dhyana, that flow of cognition. And now we have seen samadhi in detail in the first chapter. So now this is sort of just touching upon that. The flow of cognition that came in the dhyanam, when it comes into an arthamatra nirbhasa state of that is known as samadhi. Which means the cognition in the chitta, even the part where usually if there is a state of cognition, there is a knowledge that I know this, or I am thinking this, I am seeing this, I know this. That also goes away and the artha matra remains. Artha here is not really meaning. Artha means so if you say the indriya, the chakshu indriya, the eye is looking at a cow, then the cow is the artha. So the object. So the object of the knowledge alone stays in the chitta. And the subjective realization that object is being known by me, that also goes away. Arthamatra nirbhasa. That state is samadhi. And here we have seen the samadhi and samapatti are related terms. Then we have seen for samapatti, savitarka, nirvitarka, savichara, nirvichara. Then the sampragnata samadhi, asampragnata samadhi and so on. But in the ashtanga context where we are seeing, there is a certain progression. for a yogi, going from asana to pranayama to pratyahara to dharana, then dhyana, and then his chitta arrives at a state of samadhi. That is sam plus avrasdha, and that is the samadhi here. And when the artha matra nirbhasa state comes, then he has reached samadhi. And as we know, yoga ha samadhi. So the very first chapter, very first sutra, Vyasa started by saying, yoga is samadhi. So then here, these are the yoga angas. And the yoga angas proceed, developing in a yogi as he starts with an asana, then introduces pranayama, then brings in the pratyaharic elements, which automatically leads to dharana in the chitta, which further progresses and sort of there's a fruition into dhyanam, and then further on to samadhi. So these are the eight angas, and what we just covered is a brief description of all these terms. And after this, we'll also go in some discussion around this about the Ashtanga Yoga from different texts.
So the 29th sutra is listing the Ashtangas. Now, it should be taken note of one thing here, that the preceding sutra mentioned about Anushthanam, and now Yama Niyamas, which would come in Anushthanam, they become Yogangas. Now, what I'm trying to say is that when it comes to us, how do we take up Ashtanga Yoga? We know something about yoga, then we learn something about yoga, and then we practice something about what we have learned. So similarly, in our case, we will have to practice these restraints called yamas. These are restraints because we have the natural tendencies to opposites, and therefore we have to restrain. We have practice restraint, like ahimsa, satya, asteya, brahmacharya, aparigraha. Our natural tendency is ahimsa, asatya, steya, abrahmacharya, and parigraha. These are our natural tendencies. So therefore, we have to restrain ourselves from these natural tendencies. That is why there are don'ts. Now, when don'ts get mentioned, when something is done quite spontaneously, quite organically, quite naturally, then we have to impose don'ts. Similarly, yamas are like don'ts, as you just now heard. So when it comes to earlier stages of Anushthana, because if you recall, I said before Anushthana, there are so many things that we have to know about yoga. After we know about yoga, we have to learn something about yoga. After learning something about yoga, then we have to practice something about those, whatever you have learned. Then we have to become more familiar. We have to become more proficient, more and more proficient, and more and more and more proficient. So yamas in earlier phase are restraints, because it is our natural tendencies to be committing to himsa, asatya, steya, etc. And therefore, they are called restraints, while the niyamas are called observances. We have to observe them. We have to observe them. Maybe we are not violating them, but we will have to still observe more meticulously. So that's how they are called restraints and observances. But when it comes to level of anushthana, understand it is totally a different kind of meaning that we should derive. Like when we say something is not bad, so that amounts to being good, that being good. But then find out the grade of it. If something is not bad and not being bad, if it is good, what is the grade of good? But when something is really good, then we say it is good. So understand these qualities: bad, not so bad, not bad, not bad at all, and then comes good, and then comes very good, and then comes very, 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 very good. So we can see the degrees of good even in something that is not bad. So when it comes to us, we will have to practice ahimsa in the sense or in a way that it is not himsa. So our practices will be such, being very neophytes, uninitiated people, our ahimsa will be of the nature of not committing himsa. Our satya will be of the nature of not committing asatya. So also about steya, not committing steya, it is our asteya. But then you can understand the higher grades, then understand the supreme grade it reaches when it comes to yoganga anusthanam. So our ahimsa is not to do himsa. But suppose somebody is Jnaneshwar, somebody is Yajnavalkya, somebody is Patanjali himself, they don't just take care to see that they don't commit himsa. There is much more for them to be in ahimsa. Rather than merely avoiding himsa, they will have to do something much more than, they will have to be more magnanimous. They have to be more nobler, magnanimous, open-minded, generous to be in ahimsa. Whereas we will not be generous. We will be just preventing ourselves from himsa. So when it comes to anusthana, understand the yama-niyama grade and not to mistake that it is our grade of practices that we are going to apply. So also this case of asanas. First we'll have to understand asana, then learn asanas. We have to be taught asana, then we'll have to practice asana, then we'll have to so slowly become familiar, then acquainted with it, and then become more used to, and then become more proficient and more proficient, etc. Now when it comes to anusthana, all these are bygone phases. And therefore, the meaning of asana there in anusthanam will be different than in our case where we are learning asanas. We have to learn so much about asanas. We have yet to learn about asanas. So, here these are angas, and when these limbs of yoga, ashtanga, are on anusthana plane, then they will work on ashuddhikshaya and jnana deepti. So not to lose the advertence on the fact that this is mentioning the eight limbs of anusthana. And then even the sutra which is going to mention, sutra and the fruits thereof will be mentioned. It is effect of anusthana. So before anusthana there are so many phases on which you should not lose the advertence. Because unless we know a little bit about yoga, we are not going to learn about it. Then we have to learn, and then we have to learn more and more, and then we have to learn and study and understand and comprehend and practice, and then slowly go towards more and more proficiency, and perhaps even what is called as perfection. And then it will be totally a different output from yama niyama asana pranayama, etc., etc. So the ashtavangani with reference to anusthanam should not be unsighted as a purport of the text. For us to understand, the purport can be temporarily set aside, but we should again come back to this, that this is a purport with angas of anusthanam. And because the effects of this will be mentioned, which are effects of anusthanam of the angas and not practices of angas. Our practice for ahimsa will not give what the fruit is mentioned here. Our practice of asanas will not give us what the fruit of asanas is mentioned here. So is the case of pranayama. So these are angas, and more particularly of anusthana, generally of all those stages which come as prelude, as precursors to anusthana. So there is a long list of precursors to anusthanam. If you have taken some understanding from what I said in the last session. So that's how ashtangas are mentioned. And these ashtangas are also mentioned in all various texts, classical texts of yoga, Ashtanga Yoga concept is very classical concept. It is not Patanjali's original concept. It comes in Ayurveda Samhita. It comes in Pancharatra. It comes in Yajnavalkya Smriti. It comes in Yoga Upanishads also. That there are Ashtangas and same Ashtangas for yoga mentioned even in pre Patanjali literature on yoga. And of course, Patanjali has borrowed from those, and because he is he had the Anushasanam, he is not a propounder of yoga, he is expounder of yoga. So Ashtangas do come in Yoga Upanishads. Ashtangas do come in other texts of yoga, even prior to Patanjali. Texts prior to Patanjali also mention Ashtangas. So the concept of Ashtanga Yoga is very classical, to which Patanjali has adhered to. Okay.
So now, let us look at some allied discussion. So, an interesting discussion in one of the texts says, Nanucha, Yoga Shastrantareshu, Asanadinyeva Shadangani, Tadyata, Shadango Yoga Uchate Ityadi. So, one objection that is raised is, don't many of the texts say, Shadango Yoga Uchate? So, this comes in certain Upanishads. So, Asana onwards, aren't those the only six Angas? So, then why these eight Angas? And why the question kimcha sakshat asanadini eva samade rupakurvanti na yamaniyamau. So the objector is saying directly sakshat asana and onwards only give rise to samadhi, not yamaniyama, because essentially for the samadhi process a yogi will go, he will sort of assume a certain asana and then bring in pranayama, pratyahara, which will lead to dharana, dhyana, samadhi. So from a perspective of sakshat directly, it begins with a certain asana and can end with samadhi. So those are the only six. And the Shruti texts are also saying shadanga yoga uchyate. Then why the ashtangas, why the yamaniyamas? There it is answered, naisha doshaha. So this is not incorrect. There is no fault here. Because Yamaniyamavator yogadhikaropapattehe. So only one who has yama and niyama. So that is known as Yamaniyamavan. So here it is said Yamaniyamavataha, of one who has yama and niyama. Only he has the yogadhikara. Only he qualifies for yoga. And therefore, it says Yamaniyama is, it is valid to have Yamaniyama as the angas. Nahi yatha kamachari naam yoga adhikaraha. If someone behaves as he pleases, yatha kamachari. If someone behaves as he pleases, then there is no yoga adhikara for him. He is not qualified for yoga. And then there are some shruti texts. So na virato duscharita na shantaha. Or yesham tapo brahmacharyam yeshu satyam pratishtitam. So these are shruti vakyas in Atharva Veda and so on. That is bringing out that for someone to be qualified for yoga, there is mention of satya, tapa, brahmacharya, etc. So this further justifies the inclusion of yama and niyama in the yoga angas. Also, there is a illustration of the Gita, Bhagavad Gita. It's a tata gita yam brahmachari vrate sthitaha, it is said in the Gita. So therefore, it's said tasmad yama niyama yoho api angatvam. Therefore, yama niyamas also qualified to be yogangas. Yamaniyamayoshcha yamasya pratamopadanam pradanyakhyapanartham. Now the next question. Okay, yamaniyamas can be part of it. Okay, they are also angas. Why is yama coming first? So here it is said, for pratamopadanam pradanyakhyapanartham, to show the importance that yamas are to be inculcated first, and therefore it is being listed here first. Yamasya hi pradanyam sarvatra siddham. In all the texts, in the Shrutis and Smritis, it is seen that the prominence of inculcating yama is primary, therefore it is first. Yama niyama yuktasya adhikratasya yoginaha asanadi angani purva purve sthirapada praptasya uttarottara anushthanam praptam. This is also a very nice sentence. It says, one who has, the yogi who has the yama niyama inculcated, yama niyama yuktasya adhikratasya yoginaha, he has yama and niyama, therefore he has the qualification, he has the yoga adhikara. For him, asanadi anganam, for all the other angas, starting with asana, purve purve sthirapada praptasya uttarottara anushthanam praptam. So, for the other angas, as there is a sthirapadam, which means, and we will see again, I'll cover that soon afterwards. But some gets a certain amount of qualification, certain, it's known as sthirapadam, something has been attained and it can be sustained. So in this list, as the earlier angas get attain more and more of the sthirapadam, as he is more and more qualified, he is able to attain it and sustain it, then uttarottarasya, the subsequent angas, anushthanam praptam, the anushthana of the subsequent angas is reached, it becomes possible. So, and therefore, he says it has to start with yama niyama, and as in these there is greater and greater qualification, then there is a chance of reaching the anushthanam of the latter stages. Then it clarifies saying, nahi prathamam sopanam anaruya uttaram marodum shakyam. Unless one has climbed the initial steps, so imagine a staircase that one is climbing, prathamam sopanam. So unless one reaches the first step or the first stage or the earlier stage, it is not possible to climb the later stages. It says, nahi prathamam sopanam anaruya uttaram arodum shakyam. And therefore, there is this nice discussion with an objection and a justification of, firstly, why yama niyamas are included, when the Shadanga Yoga is also seen in many texts, including Hatha Yoga Pradipika. But then we see how the yama niyamas fit in, how they should be part of it, and how the sequence of these are also justified. Okay.
So, yes, Hatha Yoga texts speak about Shadanga Yoga. But then if you have a little classical understanding of it, you should know that Hatha Yoga is preceded by a yoga called Laya Yoga. Without Laya Yoga, there is no Hatha Yoga. Laya Yoga is preceded by Mantra Yoga. And Mantra Yoga is preceded by Ashtanga Yoga. So these are the levels. Ashtanga Yoga, Mantra Yoga, Laya Yoga, Hatha Yoga, then comes Raja Yoga. So it's not a different kind of yoga that Hatha Yoga is. So when Hatha Yoga mentions that there are Shadanga Yogas, it is already after Ashtanga, Mantra Yoga, Laya Yoga, according to the Upanishads. And therefore, Yama Niyamas are very much integral to very life of the practitioners of Hatha Yogi. And therefore, Yama Niyamas are there even in the Shadanga Yoga. And another wonderful description that can be given here, when you go to a florist and you say, I want a garland of roses, you just see that the rose is a garland made up of roses, studded with roses. Now, we don't look at the thread which runs through it. Now, if there is no thread running through, you can't have a garland in place. Either there should be a thread or there should be a wire that runs through. So, yama yamas are something like the wire which runs through the entire system. One of the ways is to understand these are four steps, the beginning steps to be taken. These are initial steps, and therefore you get launched on yoga. Yes, that is one way to look at it. The other one is that it is something like the thread which runs through a rose garland. But we don't look at the thread which runs through it. We don't give importance to thread. We don't say, you must give me a rose garland which is on a thread or on a wire. we just ask for rose garland. A rose garland invariably is it a thread which is woven through the stem of the flowers. So yama niyamas come like that, and therefore they are very, very integral. So for us, you and me, there are initial steps. But those who are yogis, and in Shadanga Yoga, it is like a thread running through the garland. Yama niyamas are the thread on which Shadanga Yoga is woven. So in any case, the yama niyamas do come. There is no case that there are some yoga without yama niyamas and some yoga with yama niyamas. That is not the case. Either yama niyamas come as initial steps, which are mandatory, or in rich culture of it, it is like a thread running through a garland, a thread running through a necklace. You can't have a necklace without something holding the pieces of it together, the pearls together. There is a pearl, a necklace of pearls. There must be something which is running through the pearls. Otherwise, it won't be a necklace. So, yama niyamas are like that. Either they are initial steps. This is in initial stages, unprepared stages. But when you are in well-prepared stages, there is nothing like Shadanga Anusthana. In Shadanga Anusthana, yama niyamas will be going like thread in necklace or in a garland. So they will be not only initial stages, they will be more profound in samadhi, because they are running through the entire process of yoga. So they are like sutra, they are like thread in entire yoga. So that's also another way of looking at it. For you and me, there are initial stages and steps. You must first practice a minimum satya, yama niyamas, and then only you qualify. Yes, that is right. But then, having gone past the first and second steps, it doesn't mean that we can do away with it. Because staircase is always the case. You know, you climb up. You are on the seventh step. And suppose all the six steps are removed, you will collapse. You don't have to say that there is no meaning for six steps which I have already climbed. Your seventh step is over the six steps. Now, if all the six steps are removed, your seventh step will collapse and you will also collapse. So, when we climb staircase, it is not proper to hold the steps earlier crossed over as immaterial, because they are still supporting you, your step. Maybe 7th or maybe 8th or maybe 10th or maybe 100th. All earlier steps are supporting it. And therefore, it is connected with every step. Yamaniyamas are connected to every step of yoga. It is not that now yamaniyamas are practiced. Now, some people have that notion. First yama, then niyama, and then asana, then pranayama. No, that is not the way. It is integral process. Yoga. Yoga has a meaning also. Integral. So, every aspect is integral to every other aspect. Asana is integral to even samadhi. You can't say that there is no asana in samadhi. Asana is integral to that samadhi as well. Somewhere Brahma Sutra says asina sambhavat. It is only, you should be asina. You must be settled in asana. So this yoga is an integral process. It is not that you discard earlier stages having got to next stages. And yama niyamas are like thread which run through. So even in case of Shadanga Yoga, one thing is that it is always after Ashtanga Yoga practices that you get mantra yoga practices of 16 limbs, then comes 9 limbs Laya Yoga, and then comes 6 limbed Hatha Yoga. So Shadanga Yoga also has yama niyamas very much in it, either as earlier stages, earlier steps, or as qualifying steps, or more properly, they are almost like a thread running through entire Shadangas of Hatha Yoga. That's how it should be understood. You can't do away with Ashtanga. There is no yoga bereft of yama niyamas. don't imagine there can be yoga bereft of yama niyama. So let us embrace that yoga, so we don't have to practice yamas and niyamas, etc. Yama niyamas are so integral in one sense, and also very primary, fundamental, foundational as well. So I'm getting what the meaning you should be getting. Okay.
Yes. So the danger with the analogy of steps or the staircase is one wrong understanding could be once you have climbed a step, it doesn't matter anymore. But here it is anushthanam. So when there is anushthanam done, it is always with you. It is establishing, inculcating. The other is you can't go to the next step until the first step is perfected. Again, that is not the case. Like was just said, it is an integral process. And there is a certain sequence, but it is not one after another. They go one after one, but all going together forward. So now, there's another text that discusses this nicely. It says, so yama niyama asana pranayama and so on. So tatra yamaha swata eva saphalatvad atyavashyakaha. So your yamas are very important. Why? Swata eva saphalatvad. They are capable of bearing fruit on their own. Sarva mumukshu jana sevya adau. This is to be followed by all the mumukshu jana. So mumukshu is one who is seeking liberation. So anybody in the path of yoga who is seeking liberation, the seva of the yamas is essential. And the yamas themselves are swata eva saphala. So on their own, they can bear fruit. Paschat tatsa peksha niyamaha. So here it is said, the niyamas are tatsa peksha. So the niyamas expect that the yamas have been inculcated. So it is sa peksha. Etat ubhayadhina chittasthairya sa pekshani asanani. So what is the nature of the asanas? They are ubhayadhina chittasthairya sapeksha. Means the asanas to bring about the phala. There is an expectation, there is an apeksha that the ubhaya, the yamas and the niyamas have led to certain chittasthairya or certain orientation of the chitta and a certain steadiness coming about. Then the asana phala will bear fruit more fruitfully. So, etad ubhaya adhina chittasthairya sapekshani asanani. Tat sapekshaha pranayamaha. So, now the asanas bearing fruit, the ability of that, the pranayama has an apeksha of that. This pranayama sort of expects that is in place. The tat sapekshaha pranayamaha, tat sapekshaha pratyaharaha, tat sapekshaha dharana, tatsapeksham dhyanam, tatsapekshah samadhi. Therefore, this is how a relation is drawn among the eight angas in this particular text. Iti ashtau sakshat paramparayava. Now this paramparayava savikalpa nirvikalpasya samadehe angani ityartha. Ashtanga maitune kriya nishpattehe angino angatvavat samade rangino angatvam va bodhyam. So the kriya nishpatti, the bringing about of the entire yoga and the samadhi, is from ashtanga maitune, all the eight angas coming together, and therefore they are the angi is the yoga or the samadhi, and the angas are these which there is a all of them have to be operating together. That is Ashtanga Maithune. Plus there is a parampara. That there is a certain sequence where one helps for the next to bear fruit. So both this Maithunam and the parampara are to be understood and are essential. And then they bring about the Kriya Nishpatti. And therefore they are the Angas of the Angin. So they are the parts or the... in some sense, avayava, the limbs, or even the chinna. The another meaning of the anga is something called Lakshman or Lakshma, which is like a chinna, an indicator. So all of these angas are that. and they operate in terms of a group together with a parampara among them, and that is how this ashtanga is to be understood, to bring about the kriya nishpatti of the nature of the sampragnata and then further asampragnata samadhi and then the kaivalyam. So that's another very nice way of understanding this. Now another thing that we'll see here is, we just looked at a line that said, Yamaniyama yuktasya adhikritasya yoginaha asanadi anganam purva purve sthirapada praptasya uttarottara anusthanam praptam. So for a yogi who has Yamaniyama inculcated, then asanadi anganam purva purva sthirapadam, as the earlier angas gets a certain sthirapadam, then the later angas, the uttarottara angas, he reaches the anushthanam, the inculcation of that. Now, in another text, a similar thing is said with some concrete description of how this mechanism works. So we'll look at that. So this is in the Jyotsnatika. It says, Asanena kayika vyapare tekte pranendriyeshu vyaparastishthati. Kumbakena prana nirode pranendriya vyapare tyakte manasi vyaparastishthati. Pratyahara dhyarana dhyana sampragnyata samadhibhi manasika vyapare tyakte buddho vyaparastishthati. So essentially there is a sequence being, so we'll look at the meaning, and then it says, asango hi ayam purushaha iti shrutehe अपरिणामी शुद्धः पुरुषः सत्त्वगुणात्मिका परिणामिनि बुद्धिरिति. सो हियर इट इज सेड इन द आसनास द कायिक व्यापार द बॉडीली एक्शंस एक्टिविटी गोज अवे कायिक व्यापार बिकॉज द स्टेडीनेस इज रीच्ड कायिक व्यापारे त्यक्ते वंस दैट इज removed. So we will see the prayatna shaitilyam. So when the bodily activity is given up, there is still activity in the prana and the indriyas. Then through pranayama and kumbhaka, when the prana undergoes regulation, then the activity in the pranas and the indriyas, pranendriya vyapare takte, that activity is given up, and manasi vyaparas tishtati. In the manas, there is still the potential for activity. There is still activity. Then pratyahara dharana dhyana sampragnyata samadhibhi manasika vyapare tyakte. The next angas come about to give up the vyapara or the activity, purposeful activity, that is given up. And here it says buddho vyaparas tishtati. In the buddhi, there is still vyapara. So in the buddhi, there is still vyapara. Now what does the buddhi here refer to? Buddhi refers to the shuddha sattva gunatmika parinamini buddhi, as opposed to the asangohi ayam purushaha, which is purusha is aparinami and shuddha, unchanging and pure. Whereas the buddhi is sattva gunatmika, that state of buddhi, the shuddha buddhi or the buddhi sattva is being referred to here. And that buddhi can undergo change. And there is still vyaparas tishthati. There is still activity. Because even in the sampragnyata samadhi state, there is a support. There is an alambanam in the chitta. And that is the vyapara in the buddhi. That is the buddhi still having some activity, so to speak. It is in a certain state. Then beyond this point, paravairagyena dirghakala sampragnyata abhyasenaiva va buddhi vyapare parityakte nirvikara swarupavasthitir bhavati saiva, here it's known as the asampragnyata samadhi. So essentially we have seen earlier that virama pratyaya abhyasa purva, so that is what is being referred to here. Now the relevance of all of this to the ashtanga yoga is how it has been described, going from asanam, where we saw purva purva, the earlier angas as they take shape, the Uttarottara Angas Anushtanam happens. Here from the, what is the transformation at each stage? So the Kayika Vyapara and giving up of that in the asana, then the Pranendriya Vyapara and giving up of that in Pranayama, and then further there is still Manasika, Manasi Vyapara Stishtati, so Manasika Vyapara, and that is given up. Then in the Buddhi Sattva, the Shuddha Buddhi, there is a still a Vyapara which is given up by the Virama Pratyaya Abhyasa. So again, how these Angas are working together, both in a certain parampara, in the sense of going one to other, as well as together, that's which is known as Yugapat, all of them acting or bringing about the fruit, the Kriya Nishpatti together. And so this is how this particular sutra of how these eight Angas are the Angas of Yoga, where Yoga has Samadhi, is to be understood here.
So it should be understood with the sutra that there is Anga Samadhi and Angi Samadhi. Samadhi also comes in Ashtangas. So that's a part of Yoga, like a limb of Yoga. Yama is a limb, Niyama is a limb, Asana, Pranayama, Pratyahara, Dharana, Dhyan. Samadhi is also a limb. So that is called Anga Samadhi and then Angi Samadhi. Angi Samadhi is Asampragna Samadhi, and Sampragnat and earlier to Asampragnat Samadhi, whatever Samadhis occur, they are called Anga Samadhis. So Samadhi is also one of the limbs of Yoga, and the whole of it is also called Yoga. Therefore, we have to understand there is a mention by implication of Anga Samadhi and Angi Samadhi. So earlier Samadhi is the Anga, and the whole of Yoga is the Angi Samadhi, part and the whole. Whole Yoga is Samadhi, part of Yoga is also Samadhi. Then you also can have an inference that your proficient asana or pranayam also has the full Yoga. It is a part of full Yoga. Yoga will be there even in your ahimsa, satya, asteya. But Ahimsa itself is not Yoga. However, Yoga has Ahimsa. Yoga includes Ahimsa, Satya, Asteya. Although you may not be clinically able to identify Yoga in your Ahimsa, because our Ahimsa is by the way of nature of not committing Himsa. And therefore, we don't see Yoga in our Ahimsa. But in quintessential Ahimsa, Yoga too will be there, because it is part of it. It is Anga of it. So somewhere we have to construe Anga Angi Sambandham, the part and whole relationship, to put it in scientific terms. So that also is something that you must inquire into. A part is only part when it is a part of the whole. If it is not part of the whole, then that part is not part at all of it. So Anga Angi usage in philosophical system is really vital. And here, Anga-Angi relationship is established between the limbs of Yoga and the whole of Yoga. Okay.
Yes. So we have seen the Sutra 2.29, and like Vyasa says, Yathakramam Etesham Anushtanam Swarupam Cha Vakshyamaha. We'll go over the Swarupa and the Anushtanam of all of these one by one in the following the subsequent sutras. So we'll stop here for today and recite the shlokas on Guruji. Vaijnanikam pravaktritva asane shukalavidam yoga abhyase cha tatvajnam vandeham sundaram gurum yoga vriksho hilokesmin yat prerana varditah yoga acharya guru tubhyam sundaraya namo namah. Thank you.
Namaskar.